I'm very happy and proud to present today an Italian writer, Amara Lakhous. Amara Lakhous, I have to say, first of all, that this is an event that has been jointly organized with the University of Toronto in the framework of the Goggio lectures that the University of Toronto is organizing, the Italian department of the University of Toronto is organizing every 2 weeks. They have this regular, on a regular basis, they offer this Goggio lectures, inviting scholars from Italy or from Canada and the US to give lectures on Italian subjects. This occasion was, for me particularly, because they decided to invite an Italian writer, Amara Lakhous, as I say. And it is an Italian writer that is, for me, particularly very, very important in the contemporary landscape of Italian literature, because he's an Algerian-born, so French mother tongue writer. Amara Lakhous came to Italy in 95 with his degree in philosophy at the University of Algiers, and continued to study in La Sapienza, I guess, in Rome, to get another degree in cultural anthropology. And from that starting point, he became a writer. He probably was a writer before, but in French, he became an Italian writer. And this, I think, it's a very peculiar aspect for the Italian literature nowadays, because the numbers of Italian writers that come from another language and from another culture, it's a number that is increasing, and bringing, of course, a lot of new theme and a lot of new point of views to the Italian literature. And as you probably know, Italy is a very, I would say, monocultural country. I mean, to be Italian, it's of course, we have this huge difference in regional, there is a large regional diversity, and everybody is very proud of its own city and of its own regional culture. But at the end of the day, Italy is a very Italian culture and country. And the literature, pretty much. I mean, as we know, the literature starting from Dante, and it was built up on the Italian. The Italian language was the main core on which the Italian literature was then built. So we are now in a very important phase when a lot of new Italians arise, and a lot of new Italians start to a lot. Some new Italians start to write and to bring, as I say, new themes and new point of view in the Italian culture. And I think this is very important and will bring a new, will for surely enrich a lot the Italian culture and Italian literature. So, one of the most important writers among those is Amara Lakhous, that I'm really happy to invite here to give his lecture. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much. First of all, I would like to thank University of Toronto, Italian Department, and the Italian Cultural Institute for this invitation. So the title of my talk is The Challenge of Diversity, Italy and Its Immigrants. The theme of diversity is very central in my all Italian novels, because I wrote my first novel about Algeria, then I wrote four novels about Italy. Two of them take place in Rome, where I lived 16 years, and two take place in Turin, where I moved in 2012 in order to write about a very important neighborhood in Turin, San Salvario. So this theme is very central in my novels, but it's also very important in my life because I was born in Algiers in a very Berber family. So I learned Berber, its native language is North Africa, and I learned Arabic, and then I studied French at elementary school. So at age of, I think, nine, I could speak in three languages. So I can't live just in one language. And when I moved to Italy, I learned Italian and I started to write in Italian. I was born in very interesting family. I have five sisters and three brothers. We have the same father, we have the same mother, we had the same education, but we are very different. Really very different. Physically, for example, I have a brother, blonde, it's very blonde, and I have another brother darker than me. So, and you know, they are more intelligent, less intelligent, more generous, less generous, etc. So the diversity, I did the diversity in my family. So for me, it's really very, very important. Really, very, very important. When I moved to Italy in 1995, of course, I discovered the big diversity. You know, in Algeria, so I was Berber, Arab, and Muslim. So I was part of a big majority. So when I moved to Italy, I changed completely. I became part of minority. And when you are part of minority, I consider minority a big opportunity, a big chance to be creative. Because when you are part of majority, you are lazy. You have all answers. You are protected by politics, by culture, by history. But when you are part of minority, you have to be really very, very original. You have to find new answers. You have to ask new questions. So I'm going to read some passages of my novels in order to introduce this theme and to discuss with you, because I don't have really the truth. So I would like to discuss with you and to have your comments and critics and observations. So the first passage is from this novel, Clash of Civilizations over an Elevator in Quetzalcoatl. There are 12 characters, and each character has his point of view or truth. One of the most characters in this novel is the Benedetta Esposito, the Neapolitan concierge. And in this passage, I would like to develop a very important concept about real diversity and false diversity. So the truth of Benedetta Esposito. I am sure the murderer of Lorenzo Manfredini is one of the immigrants. The government should hurry up and do something. Soon, they will be throwing us out of our own country. All you have to do is take a walk in the afternoon in the gardens in Piazza Vittorio to see that the majority of the people are foreigners. Some come from Morocco, some from Romania, China, India, Poland, Senegal, Albania. Living with them is impossible. They have religions, habits, and traditions different from ours. In their countries, they live outside or in tents. They eat with their hands. They travel on donkeys and camels and treat women like slaves. I'm not a racist, but that's the truth. Even Bruno Vespa on TV says so. Bruno Vespa, I think in Italians here know who he is. Is one of the most important journalists. For me, it's not really good journalist. It's a very bad model of journalism. But this is another question. Because I was a journalist in Italy for many years. I worked in an Italian news agency. I know very well this world. And my character, my main character in dispute over a very Italian piglet, it's a journalist from his parents from Calabria in the south, but he is born in Turin. Even Bruno Vespa on TV says so. Then why do they come to Italy? I don't know. We are followed up with the employed. My son Gennaro doesn't have a job. If it weren't for his wife Marina, who's a seamstress, and help from me, he would have ended up as a beggar outside the church of Saint Domenico Maggiore in Naples. If there is no work for the people of this country, how is it that we welcome all this disparate types? Every week, we see boats loaded with illegal immigrants on the TV news. They bring contagious diseases like plague and malaria. Emilio Fede always says so, but no one listens to him. Emilio Fede is the worst. So we have Bruno Vespa and we have Emilio Fede. So this passage is about false diversity. Because Benedetta Esposito in this passage says that these the countries, Poland. So what are the differences between Italians and Polish? They are Europeans. They are white, and they are Catholics. So what is the difference here? The number of the observations, it's very, very important. The origin of this information is TV. So for this reason, I think that media is playing a very bad role in this, in communication. Very, very bad role. So, so this is the first consideration. It's about the false diversity. The second passage is about Maria Cristina Gonzalez is a Peruvian, is immigrant Peruvian. So I'm going to read this passage, and I can comment and say something. So the truth of Maria Cristina Gonzalez. Señora Rosa is 18. She was paralyzed 10 years ago, and she only leaves her wheelchair to go to the bathroom or to lie down in her bed. She has 4 children. Would take turns coming to see her every Sunday for a few hours. When one of them arrives, my weekly holiday begins from noon to midnight. I don't know what to do to enjoy my brief time off. I look at the hands of the clock on the wall and hope from the bottom of my heart that time will stop, so my freedom will last longer. I do all I can not to waste precious minutes. I make plan filled with activities, but in the end, I do the same thing every time. I go to the station where the Peruvian immigrants gather. Their faces satisfy my thirsting eyes, and their words warm my cold ears. It seems to me I have gone home to Lima. I greet them all with a kiss, even if I have never seen them before. Then I sit on the sidewalk and eat Peruvian food, rice and chicken and lomo saltado and chivish. I talk for hours. I talk more than I listen. That's why they call me Maria Cristina the Shutterbox. When the sun begins to set, I get more and more depressed, knowing that my journey to freedom is about to end. So I cling to the bottles of beer and pisco to shelter myself from that storm of sadness. I drink a lot to forget the world, to forget my problems. I'm not the only one who has to deal. I'm not the only one who has to deal with old age and imminent death every day. There are a lot of us, innated by the destiny of our work with our people, who at any moment will move to another world. As the time passes, we are transformed into stray dogs. Some let their tongues go, hurling insults in Spanish and Italian. Some provoke the people sitting nearby, and so in an instant fists are raised and kicks and punches fly. I, instead, move silently out of sight, and under the wing of night go with a young man who resembles me in every way. Each of us empties into the other's body our own desire, hope, anguish, fear, sadness, rage, hatred, and disappointment. And we do this quickly, like animals afraid of missing the season of fertility. We lie on an isolated bench or on pages of newspapers spread out on the ground. So this is the truth of Maria Cristina Gonzalez. It's about solitude, the solitude of immigrants. Immigrants everywhere, everywhere, everywhere. The immigrants have the same feeling. And is the comment of Amedeo. Amedeo is the moderator, is the coordinator of the story, and coordinator of a different truth. So this is the comment of Amedeo. Tonight, I saw a great film on TV with Alberto Sordi and Claudia Cardinale, which tells the story of certain Amedeo, an immigrant who works in Australia. The life of Italian immigrants in the past closely resembles the life of the immigrants arriving in Italy today. Throughout history, immigrants have always been the same. All that changes is their language, their religion, and the color of their skin. Benito Esposito, in the previous passage, said, if there is no work for the people of this country, how is it that we welcome all these disparate types? This is a big misunderstanding, maybe stereotype, about immigrants as thieves of work. So they come in Italy to steal work for a time. It's not true. This is not true. Very interesting book published maybe 3-4 years ago by Riccardo Staliano. is my friend, journalist, Republican, Espresso. He wrote a book about the work of the immigrants. So he traveled around Italy and he so he went in different cities to tell different jobs that immigrants do. And in this book, all works and all jobs that immigrants do, Italians refuse to do it. Because they are very, very hard jobs, very, very hard jobs. For example, the job of Cristina González, she stays with this old woman all the day, even the night. It's very, very hard work. And in Italy, there are one million of women. We call them badante, so they cure the old people, etc. And here, it is a very interesting observation. Because in general, like Benedetta Esposito, there is no, she doesn't trust immigrants. But we have this big paradox in Italy. So in one hand, so people don't choose immigrants because they believe they are bad people. On the other hand, we have millions of workers, women mostly, they work in the houses, and the Italians give them the keys of their houses. So they can enter, you know, in the bedroom, they can. So this is a big paradox. So, and they give them, they ask them to take care of their parents and their children. So it's the maximum of trust. This is a big paradox, really big paradox. Now I'm going to read another two passages from dispute over a very Italian piglet. The story takes place in Turin. And the first chapter takes place in Marseille. You are going to discover why Marseille in France. So the main character, Enzo Lagana, this journalist, narrates the story. It's in the first person. It's about 10 minutes walk to Jean-Pierre's house in the Panier. I leave the hotel on the Quai du Port, carrying two gifts and a bunch of roses. I turn onto Rue de la Prison, then I take Monte Bizacou. The Panier is the soul of Marseille. It's also the city's memory. There are still traces of Piemontese and Neapolitan immigrants. Jean-Pierre was born here. His grandfather was a socialist and anti-fascist who fled Turin in the 20s. More than half the Marseillais are of Italian origin. I met Jean-Pierre 10 years ago in the Turin Book Fair. He came to deliver a talk on Marseille. The fact that he had Italian origins was an immediate bond between us. I am very drawn to people who have complicated roots, like me. I was born in Turin to parents from Calabria. In Turin, when I was a child, I was called the Calabrese. While in Calabria, I was called a Turinese. In other words, from neither here nor there. So this is the other passage. So he is going to his house friend for dinner. So then we change the location. After this chat with his friend, we sit at the table. It's typical Marseille dinner. soup opistu with aioli and tarte tatin, made by Sandrine, his wife. Jean-Pierre never moved out the panier. His brothers and sisters left years ago. He decided to give his son an Italian name because he wants to be reconciled with his origins. He has often told me stories of children who were ashamed of their Italian surnames. The same thing happened to us Southerners in the cities of northern Italy. When I was at school in Turin, my Sicilian, Calabrian, and Neapolitan friends were embarrassed to say that their names were Salvatore, Carmelo, or Rosario. Other kids were always making fun of them, not to mention the Pasquales, Gennaros, etc. Poor kids, they had to endure endless teasing. It's hard not to make a comparison today with the children of immigrants who have Arabic or African names. In reality, in my novels, in my Italian novels, I tried to connect three moments or three memories or three topics. So the Italian immigration in the world, and the Italians really have incredible story, really incredible story, because they immigrated everywhere. Australia, for example, I have been in Australia 3 years ago. I went to Perth in the east. There is a small Sicilian community from the same town in Sicily, next to Cefalù. They immigrated all to the village in Perth. It's an incredible story. It's a really incredible story. And it wasn't easy. It wasn't easy because they didn't speak English. And for Australian, by the way, Italians and Greeks were considered not white. Not black man, not white. This is very interesting about a racial discourse. And so here we have another last passage of from the dispute over a very Italian people. So this is a dialogue between Enzo Lagana, the journalist, and this Enzo Mario Bellizzi. So one, my left is Mario Bellizza, and my right is Enzo Lagana. For me, integration means accepting everything. That's not integration, but assimilation, colonialism. I don't give a good damn. If a Muslim immigrant comes and tells me he wants to stay in our country and maybe become an Italian citizen, you know what I ask him? What? Do you like beer? Do you eat prosciutto? And if he says no, dear Muslim, I'm sorry, but you don't have the necessary qualifications. Very interesting, Mr. Enzo. So here the comment of Enzo. So we should add to the qualifications of citizenship the pork test. We call them the pork test. This is my invention. Maybe it will be more decisive than the Italian language test. Look, if there is a word that pisses me off, it's certainly that one, integration. I have heard it ever since I was born. People like Bellizza don't remember, or maybe don't want to remember, the ugly welcome that surfers, Meridionali, got in the northern cities like Milan and Turin. Because Bellizza actually is originally from Calabria. So they arrived at Porta Nuova station, the main station in Torino. They arrived at Porta Nuova after a long journey on the Torino del Sole, the sun train, which starting from Palermo and Siracusa formed a single convoy and traveled through Calabria, Basilicata, Campania, Lazio, Tuscany, and Liguria. Then, too, as now, it was said that the new arrivals called Napoli or even Moroccans, they called them Moroccans, could not be integrated. They were painted as backward, illiterate, dangerous, carriers of crime of every sort. Much better to keep them at a distance. We don't rent to the southernest. Non si affitta ai meridionali. Was the slogan of that welcome, soon forgotten. I remember it all, the laughter of my classmates, when my last name was pronounced, Lagana. Yes, I was ashamed and wished for a different name, not a Calabrian name, but one as northern as possible. I remember the questions they asked when I was a child. It's true that you grow basil in bathtub. And why are you lazy good for nothing? Such scorn, such humiliation. Then people thought it was better to hide the sheet under the carpet, turn the page without even reading it. I wonder, could there possibly be integration without acceptance, without respect, without understanding, without memory? I think this is the problem. This is the problem. The biggest problem is memory. And I always say that I'm Italian because I love Italy, because I write in Italian, and my novels were translated from Italian into English, Japanese, Spanish, and the most interesting thing is French. So my novels were translated from Italian to French, and in Algeria I have a publisher. So he published my novel in Algeria in French. So Italy is like a bridge. It's like a bridge between Algeria and French. And you know, there is a big story, the colonialism story, colonialist story, and this very dramatic story. So Italy is very, very important. So I am Italian, but I am not very Italian. Sono italiano, ma non italianissimo. Because I was born in Algeria, my parents are Algerian and Muslim, so the majority of Italians, of course, are Catholics. But I'm so proud of this identity, my Italian identity, and I always say this in Algeria. And actually, I wrote an article yesterday, published an article in Arabic newspaper, and I said I am very happy with my three identities, Berber, Arab, and Italian. So I am so proud of my Italian identity because I constructed this identity with my hands, with my passion, with my efforts. So my Berber and Arab identity, or Muslim identity, are part of my heritage. So I didn't make any big efforts. But for my Italian identity, I spent time to learn Italian, to know Italian culture. So, and my love for Italy pushes me to be very sincere And in my novels, I am trying to maybe to help and to improve the debate in Italy, saying that Italy has incredible memory of immigration. The big story. So we can, we Italian can't say we don't have any experience with immigration. Is this not true? And we try to imitate other models like French model or English model. And the situation is completely different because in French, the majority of immigrants are from ex-colony. So the colonialism is a big burden. Italy doesn't have this burden because, you know, Italian had, Italy had a bad experience colonialism in Ethiopia, Somalia, in Libya, but Libyans and Somali or Ethiopians are very, very few in Italy. It's not big, so the biggest community in Italy of immigrants are from China, and there is no colonialism story here. From Romania, Ukraine, for example, Morocco, they are the most important, the biggest communities of immigrants. And this is very important, very, very important. And they have really a big story of immigration, not just outside, but internal. You know, they are not the, in my Tunisian novels, I talked a lot about the immigration from south to north. But there are a lot of immigrations from north to the south. For example, from Venice to Sardinia, Carbonia. Carbonia is a city in Sardinia, and there are a lot of. I met a guy there, and I saw he was blonde, and I said to him, "What are you doing here?" He said, "You know, it's my I was born here. It's my and his accent is Sardinian." So it's, he told me that his grandfather immigrated from Venice to Carbonia in the south to work. So we have other immigration from north to Lazio during the fascism. So there are big movements. We have really a big history, but unfortunately, we have today in Italy we have very a big problem about this. Maybe just one example. Regarding the children of the immigrants in Italy, so they were born in Italy. Now they are teenagers, and so we say the second generation. So they were born in Italy, and they didn't have any relationship with the country of their parents, and most of them don't speak Chinese or Arabic like Moroccans, so they feel themselves Italians, and they don't have any problem of their identity. They believe strongly that they are Italians, so they speak, of course, Italian and the dialects of their cities, and when they are 18. They become immigrants because they don't have the citizenship. And this is really a big problem. A big problem for the future. So we have more than 1 million now. And this is just an example about this, I can say, temporary failure. Because I am so optimistic, actually. I'm so optimistic because I love soccer. I love soccer. So the game is not over. You know, when the game is not over, Franco is fan of soccer too. So when the game is not over, so we can change it, we can win. So now in Italy we are losing, but fortunately the game is not over. We have to make more efforts to change the mentality, especially about this. For me, it's very, very important to discuss about citizenship for the children's, the immigrant children, immigrants' children. So, if you have questions or comments.
Good evening. Excuse me for my glasses. I left the lighter ones in the car. Otherwise, I can't see the reaction in your face. Let me see it.
I'm smiling.
In Canada, and particularly in this city, we could be teachers for Europe as to the evolution of the blendings of peoples. All the comments that you made, difficulties, acceptances, we went through that, not in the last chapter, in the last book. I'm very curious on your perspectives, meaning Europe is struggling to come into grips with what the peoples of Canada, who came from many, many countries, there was a dominance of one group and a second group. However, the experience in Canada has been that the fundamental root for migration was economic. I noticed that you highlight cultural identity, and I understand you have a cultural anthropology preparation. For me, and at least for some of us who have had to observe firsthand the evolution of fitting into another society, and then having a share of that society, begins and is continually centered on the nucleus of economic survival. Most of the people who came to Canada, and is from what we see in reports in media, most of the people who go to Europe don't go because they don't like their country or because they don't like their culture. So in the next evolution of migrations of peoples, I'm curious whether you have addressed or beginning to address the issues of where do we go from here, because the experiences of peoples in Europe, they'll go through what Canada went through. Not the Americans. The Americans took a totally different approach. Canada has been very successful, such that many of us consider ourselves as human beings first. We are Italians, or Greeks, or Anglo-Saxon, and we live in Canada and demand a share while retaining our identity. And as you well know, identity now has become a confusing subject. We have many identities. I propose and suggest that the next discussion has got to be worldwide. Why should there be any more migrations, and how do we deal with the economic fundamentals of survival?
It's a big the Lord said once, "A vast project." It's a very, very big topic. I think thinking about the Canadian model, I think the most important thing today is the debate about multiculturalism. You know, in Europe, there is a big debate about this, and there are a lot of politicians, intellectuals, declared that multiculturalism has failed. David Cameron, the Prime Minister, English Prime Minister, Angela Merkel, the German Prime Minister, so they said has failed. And I think there is no alternative to multiculturalism. Actually, we have an alternative. The alternative is monoculturalism. Monoculturalism, we experienced actually this model, and the result were fascism, Stalinism, and Talibanism, Nazism, etc. So the multiculturalism for me is really a big challenge, and we don't have other option actually. There is no option for this. We have just this serious option, the magical challenge. But the challenge is to find harmony. And I can talk about myself. I tried to take the best of all my cultures. Algerian culture, French culture, and Italian culture. For this reason, I don't like the concept of integration. Integration means you take something and you integrate it into some other thing, like this. This is integration. But the best is to integrate yourself in the best part. So in Italy, for example, I integrate myself in the best, because in Italy they are, of course, they are the best part and the worst part. Again, this is a big challenge to integrate each other in the best that we have.
I'm really anxious to read your novels because I really like the idea that you brought out this immigrant to the outsider, because and the Italian citizen who immigrates or who moves within Italy as the outsider, because you know my own parents experienced that in Italy. My father would travel from the south to the north. My family is from Calabria. That's very interesting that you brought that out. And I have Sicilian friends and friends from, and of course, most of the immigration to Ontario, Quebec, Toronto, the history has been of the southern Italian immigrants who, because of the economy, came here, because of the economy. So I was very interested to hear that, because that's a unique experience, being an outsider in Italy, even though you're Italian. And then coming here in the 50s, as my parents did, and again being outsiders. But I must agree that Canada is one of the, you know, more accepting, welcoming countries in the world, and we're very happy to be here. And the fact that we can become citizens in a few years, as opposed to never, or I'm not sure if these children, it's a very incredibly wrong thing that I hope that's solved somehow. I know in France it takes years and years to become a citizen, and why is that? So that fact of the immigrant as never really truly integrating unless they totally give up their identity, as they do in the States, in the United States of America, and many find happiness. My mother's family from Calabria, many of them immigrated to the United States of America, to Pennsylvania, and they found economic and happiness there. And so I don't know what the answer is.
Yeah, I prefer the Canadian model, because you can't cut your identity. It's I think in this novel, certainly in this, because I am the author, it's a wonderful metaphor about a tree. Identity as a tree. Let me find the. My mother has always talked to me a bit in Calabrian. She refused to follow the recommendations of the teachers in the importance of using exclusively Italian with one's children. This is in Italian, of course. Once, after the handler warning, she answered in dialect at my house, "Parlo come mi piaccia," I speak however I want. My father always used to say that human beings have the same fate as trees. Deprived of their roots, they die. And there is no stronger root than language. I think he was right. A person who leaves his own land is like a tree that's transplanted somewhere else. It can be fatal to deprive it of its roots. So language, especially language, is maybe the most important root of identity, like root, like the tree.